Good morning. Great to have you join us this Sunday morning. Really exciting to see how many people have been joining us on the online services, coming together, watching locally, but also from abroad. And our hope is that it will give you a window into who we are. And maybe one day, if you're able to, you might come and join us when we get back to meeting in our church building. But for now, welcome to Worthing Baptist Church. Welcome to our morning service.
Psalm 130, a song of ascents. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. This is your word for today.
Let's pray. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. To all who confess their sins and resolve to lead a new life, he says, your sins are forgiven. And he also says, follow me.
Beautiful Lord, wonderful Saviour, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your captured by your holy calling, set me apart. I know you're drawing me to yourself. Leave me, Lord, I pray. Take me, mold me, use me, fill me. My life to the potter's hand. Call me, guide me, lead me, walk beside me. I give my life to the potter's hand.
Come to our time of offering, and as a local Baptist church, all that we do in and through the church is funded through the generosity of our members and regulars. And that's why during each service we stop, we pause, and we lift that money and also ourselves up afresh to God. So let us pray. Loving God, we thank you again today for the fellowship we share in Worthing Baptist Church, for all it offers, all it means, and all the ways it enriches our lives and the lives of others and enlarges our experience of life. We thank you for the unity we have discovered in Christ, for the love that binds us together. We thank you for the experiences we have shared over the years, for the bond they have created between us. Thank you for the care we have been able to show, especially over recent days, and the care we have in turn received. We thank you for the opportunities we've had to discuss our faith, and the way our understanding of you has grown as a result of this. We thank you for the way we can talk together openly and honestly, and know that our friendship will not only continue, but flourish. Loving God, we do not claim to be a perfect family, for we are all too conscious of our weaknesses as individuals and as a church family. But we praise you that you have called us here as one people, in fellowship with you and one another. Lord, with all of this in mind, we do offer ourselves up afresh, financially, but more than that, in the whole of who we are as individuals and as a church, that your kingdom may come both in us and through us for your glory. Amen.
The reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 24, and I'm reading from the NIV translation. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Don't quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good and reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Now, this is the same passage, and I'm now reading from the Message translation. Be cheerful no matter what. Pray all the time. Thank God no matter what happens. This is the way God wants you, who belong to Christ Jesus, to live. Don't suppress the Spirit, and don't stifle those who have a word from the Master. On the other hand, don't be gullible. Check out everything and keep only what's good. Throw out anything that's tainted with evil. And may God himself, the God who makes everything holy and whole, make you holy and whole. Put you together, spirit, soul, and body, and keep you fit for the coming of our Master, Jesus Christ. The one who's called you is completely dependable. If he said it, he'll do it.
I wonder if you would describe yourself as a patient person, because for many of us, waiting patiently is tough. All of us right now are waiting for life to return to some sort of normality, when we can go out as much as we like, when we can see whoever we want to. The amount of times I've heard recently these words, when this is all over. And patience is even harder these days when so much is instant. A lot of things are instant now. The very fact that you're watching this from your home is proof enough. It all plays at a touch of a button. And many things work like that. Do you remember when we used to wait for things? Do you remember waiting for photos to develop? Do you remember waiting for dial-up internet to connect? One area of life that has become increasingly instantaneous is cooking. A microwave, for example, can cook things in minutes. You put something in there, the microwave zaps it, and then ping, it's ready. And I wonder if most Christians see faith like a microwave. We want God to zap a situation or zap us or zap something else. We might pray, dear God, please make me patient and make me patient quickly. We might pray, dear God, please sort out my relationship with so-and-so and make them less difficult to get on with. Or we might pray, dear God, please meet with me at church in such a powerful way that my life is forever changed in an instant. Perhaps you've prayed prayers like that before. I certainly have. Sometimes with those kinds of prayers, we're just being honest with God, like a child is with a parent, and there's a lot of good in that. But often I think these kinds of prayers come out of an impatience or an inability to see God working in the ordinary, or a desire for God to kind of swoop in and sort things out so that we don't have to deal with something that's difficult. I've preached this before, and no doubt I'll preach it again, but I wonder if we need to see our faith less like a microwave and more like a slow cooker. When Jenny and I have people round for food, I love using a slow cooker. It often means you can be
truly present with your guests when they arrive, rather than worrying about the food. With a slow cooker, there's no worrying about whether the food is burning or going cold, because it just stays hot constantly. And that's because the pot is connected to this heating element constantly. And so even after the food is finished cooking, the slow cooker maintains the temperature. A microwave, on the other hand, it zaps the food, and as soon as it's finished zapping, the food starts going cold. I think God prefers to work in our lives in slow ways as we stay connected to Him daily. Often real transformation doesn't happen in a single hyped up moment. Sometimes it does, but often it doesn't. Rather, it happens in a life of trust as we seek to be attentive to Him. He's a patient God, He is, and He's in it for the long haul when it comes to us. To use our cooking analogy again, He's like a patient chef who's watching with excitement as our lives simmer and the flavours begin to emerge. This morning's sermon is called Slow Cooker Spirituality, Teachings of Paul for the Long Haul. And you might have heard me preach something like this before. Don't worry, you're not crazy if you think you have. I'm reworking an old sermon here for a present day context. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at some teachings of Paul that come right at the end of his first letter to the Thessalonians. And then these teachings, just to let you know, these teachings are not specific pastoral guidance for particular situations, but more general teaching and encouragement to help the Thessalonians persevere, even in the uncertainty of not knowing exactly when Christ will come again. So let's start with verses 16 to 18. I'll just read them again for you. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Always, continually, in all circumstances. Paul is saying, don't let anything stop you. Rejoice, pray, give thanks. This is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Paul is saying, don't burn bright with passion one day only to go cold the next. Always, continually, in all circumstances. This, right here, this is slow cooker spirituality. Staying connected to Him like a slow cooker pot to its heating element. And I think we need this slow cooker spirituality even more right now. We're not meeting together on Sundays. We're not going to festivals like Big Church Day Out or Spring Harvest. All we have is ordinary life. Our mountaintop experiences have been deferred. It's time now to live well in the valley. So here are three ideas. One about rejoicing, one about prayer, one about giving thanks. So firstly, when it comes to rejoicing, I think some sort of personal, regular engagement with Scripture is so important. And I say that because our lives, our stories, participate in something much bigger, God's story. And reading the Bible reminds us of that. We each live within our own fast-paced stories that are unfolding in real time. And depending on how life is going for you right now, your story might resemble a comedy or a drama or a rom-com or even a tragedy. And depending on how your story is going, depending on how your life is being touched by coronavirus right now, rejoicing might seem like the most unnatural or even inappropriate thing to do right now. But if your story is part of a greater story, one which is bookended by love, one in which God freely chooses to dwell with us and reconcile us to Himself in Christ, perhaps then rejoicing is possible even when everything else in our lives is going wrong. I dare you to read the Bible regularly, to rejoice, to find yourself part of something bigger. Secondly, prayer. I could talk about any manner of practices of prayer, but I'll share just one. Some people find something called the Jesus Prayer quite helpful when it comes to staying connected to God throughout the day. And the Jesus Prayer goes like this. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Some people leave off those words, a sinner, as the New Testament usually refers to Christians as saints. But either way, the Jesus Prayer is a short prayer that can be used anywhere and at any time to check in with God, to stay connected with God, and to express to God that need for mercy. You're walking to the shops. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me. You're beginning to feel anxious. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me. You've just majorly messed things up with a loved one. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me. And this is important. It's not a mantra, not something that you mindlessly repeat, but it's an aid to help you check in with God throughout the day. Thirdly, giving thanks. Keeping some sort of thankfulness journal can be really helpful when it comes to giving thanks in all circumstances, as Paul puts it. For Lent, a couple of years ago, I decided to write down at the end of each day one thing I was thankful to God for from that day. We encouraged you to do something similar this year. And I found when I did it, I don't know how you found it, but when I did it, it wasn't easy at first. It was a discipline. It kind of built as time went on. And as time went on, it got easier. And I even found myself becoming more aware of all the things I could be thankful for. Robert Emmons, a professor of psychology at the University of California, has carried out a series of studies on people who keep gratitude journals or thankfulness journals. And along with his team, Emmons found that people who kept a journal like this experienced a multitude of physical, psychological, and social benefits, including stronger immune systems, lower blood pressure, higher levels of positive emotions, joy, optimism, happiness, and they also felt less isolated. And all of that makes me wonder, if it's so good for us, perhaps thankfulness is actually part of what it means to be a healthy human being. I wonder what you think. And I also wonder, if you've tried something like a thankfulness journal before, why not share your experience in the comments of this video? We'd love to hear from you, and I'm sure it'd encourage others as well. So rejoice always, perhaps by reading scripture regularly, pray continually, perhaps with the help of the Jesus Prayer, and give thanks in all circumstances, perhaps by keeping a thankfulness journal. Let's move on now to verse 19. It's a short one. Do not quench the Spirit. I love this. To quench is to put out or extinguish. If I'm thirsty, I might drink some water to quench my thirst. It's as if the water is putting out the fire of my thirst. To quench the Spirit is to attempt to extinguish God's flame, to close down God's creative spirit, to batten down the hatches to the breath of God. To use the slow cooker analogy again, to quench the Spirit is to take the pot off the heat, to say, actually, I prefer my food raw. When I was thinking about all of this, I was thinking about wind turbines and the way that their purpose is to be turned by the wind so that energy can be produced. And we have many of these wind turbines off our coast. But imagine if these turbines were to stop turning and stopped producing energy. It would be contrary to their purpose. In the same way, it's contrary to our purpose to quench the Holy Spirit, to close up and fail to produce the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, the Spirit of God is mysterious, elusive, unpredictable. The wind blows wherever it pleases, says Jesus. And yet there is a choice that each of us can make, whether we will be open to the Spirit of God, or whether we will stop turning like a broken wind turbine, whether we close ourselves down to the breath of God, to the wind of God. At a time when we're in lockdown and many of us are closed for business, will we choose to still be open for business to God? We're all wired differently, and so being open to the Spirit will look different for each of us, but ask yourself, am I open? Am I open? Am I letting God get to me? Let's move on. Paul writes, verses 20 to 22, do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. According to these teachings of Paul for the long haul, the Thessalonians need to be open to prophecy, a gift of the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, Paul is saying. Paul is saying that it will not be healthy for their life together if every word of prophecy is immediately ignored or discredited or undermined. For Paul, it would be a terrible, terrible thing to say God doesn't speak through people anymore, only through the written scriptures. For Paul, the voice of prophecy is integral to the health of the church, so long as it is adequately tested. Test them all, hold on to what is good, reject every kind of evil, he says. Slow cooker spirituality is open to the Spirit, open to prophecy, and a commitment to discernment. We can't leap on bandwagons or get caught up in hype or buy into fads. That's microwave spirituality. If we're going to be responsive to the slow, deep, and fruitful work of God in us, we need to constantly ask of any prophetic word or picture, does it look like, sound like, remind us of Jesus? And does it fit in with what God has been doing and how God has been working among us to date? Through the years, I know that some of you have had words and pictures for this church or people in this church, and you have wondered if they might have been from God. And along the way, they've been tested, weighed, prayed into. Let's keep going with that. That is brilliant. And just because we're far away from each other, just because we can't gather like normal, that doesn't mean we need to stop. We should stop asking God for words and pictures for our church and discerning together. Discernment can still take place. This is as important a time as any to pray into the life of our church and ask God for insight. Let's move on. Verse 23. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Up to this point, we've mainly been talking about the part we play when it comes to slow cooker spirituality, staying connected to God in the everyday, for the long haul, rejoicing always, praying continually, giving thanks in all circumstances, being open to the Spirit, open to prophecy, and testing it all. But now, let's consider the part God plays. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. To sanctify something is to make it holy. And we're in the process of being made holy. And guess what? It's a slow process. There aren't any shortcuts. There is no such thing as instant holiness or holiness light or holiness express. God's in it for the long haul. His desire is to shape and mold you like a potter with clay over seasons, over years, until you are blameless in his sight. And we find in the pages of scripture that God had a rather tumultuous relationship with Israel, and yet from time to time he would regard them as right with him anyway. He says, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. In the end, it comes down to the character of God, how he sees us and who he says we are. And that leads us to the final verse, verse 24. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. We may play our part. We may respond to him, cooperate with him, stay connected to him. But in the end, he is the one. He is the one that brings it all to completion. He's that patient chef who brings out all the flavors in us and presents us blameless in his sight. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. As we come to the end of these teachings of Paul for the long haul, I want us to focus on just one word, and it's this word that I want you to preach to yourself throughout this coming week. It's the word calls. The one who calls you is faithful. To call is to name. My parents called me Peter. To call is to invite. I was called by you to be one of your ministers. I didn't push myself on you. You called me, you invited me. To call is to set apart someone for a purpose or a special relationship to oneself. So when a person has a child, they begin to be called a mother or a father, and their child begins to be called a son or a daughter. And I think that word calls in our passage carries all of that meaning for you and I. God names us, God invites us, God sets us apart for a purpose and a special relationship. This is our identity, and we can't lose sight of this, especially when we're in difficult circumstances right now. There's a parable that Jesus tells about a son who takes his inheritance, squanders it in a far off country, and then when he's at rock bottom, returns to his father's house and says to his father, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." The father is having none of it. He goes to his servants and says, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And I wonder if you see what I see. The son says, "I am not worthy to be called your son." The father calls him a son regardless and celebrates his return home. The son's identity does not rest on how he sees himself. He is called son by his father, and that is all that matters. You are called son. You are called daughter. Keep preaching that to yourself. So imagine if we had a slow cooker spirituality, one which is based on a trust that God is in it for the long haul when it comes to us. Imagine if we stayed close to him, rejoicing always, praying continually, giving thanks in all circumstances. Imagine if we remained open to the Holy Spirit, open to prophecy, committed to discernment. Imagine if we trusted that God was at work among us, slowly sanctifying us and bringing it all to completion. And imagine if we recognize that we are called to be children of God, regardless of our worthiness or how we see ourselves. We are who he says we are. Amen.
Love for me, oh, his love.
As I said at the beginning of the service, our hope is that many of you will get a taste for this church and maybe check us out afterwards when we get back to be in our church building. The words after the service say the following: Worthing Baptist Church welcomes people regardless of gender, age, physical abilities, learning difficulties, personal circumstances or mental health needs. Ministers, that's Peter and myself, also endorse Affirm, which is a network of Baptist Christians working together for LGBT plus inclusion. Whilst many members are also affirming, Worthing Baptist Church respects those within our church family who lovingly have a different understanding. So maybe you'll come along and see us and get to know us more after you've had a little window into who we are during these services, whenever that may be, whenever we're able to gather again. But until then, may the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. And may he bring you home rejoicing once again or for the first time in through our doors. Amen.
I have heard so many songs, listened to a thousand times, but there is one that sounds above them all. Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. You are singing over me, the Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me, the Father's song. I have heard so many songs, listened to a thousand times, but there is one that sounds above them. Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me. Now you're singing over me, the Father's song. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it all.